Welcome back to the Artie Lang Show. Sitting here with comic Dan Soder. Dan will be at the Stress Factory this whole weekend coming up in New Brunswick, New Jersey. And so what? So sports-wise, you're all San Francisco except for the Denver Nuggets, but who cares?
Yeah, that's...
You know, so what? Give us your thoughts on the Niners. Like, what's happening here?
I think we live in a world of a 24-hour news cycle, so they're always trying to find some, especially in the NFL.
Right.
I think two losses, I'm not happy that the Niners are 2-2, but I think in the NFL it's shown that if you heat up right before the playoffs,
that's
the most important. I think the Niners go 10-6.
Right.
They still have a shot. You know, someone's going to have to go through Seattle.
Sure they do. The Giant fans have to panic. Well,
yeah.
We have to panic, but... Right, you still have to go through. I just think it's amazing in this supposed era of the read option, the RG3, the Kaepernick, the Russell. Peyton Manning is just, he's just saying, no, this is how it's done.
Yeah. Peyton Manning's like, you know what he is? He's like the old blues musician and everyone's doing techno. And he's like, no, I can still wail on the guitar. Don't worry about me.
And blow the audience away. He's just that good. I think it's a combination of competitiveness that you'll see when you watch this documentary, right?
Yeah. Oh, I'm excited to see this. I love SEC football. I mean, I grew up in Colorado, so you'd think I'd be a Broncos fan, but my dad made sure I was a Niners and a San Francisco Giants fan,
right?
Even before he moved to Denver. But all my friends that are Bronco fans, it's like, it's funny how just cocky they are now. Where they're just like, once they got Manning, they were like, what's up? And you're all right, take it easy, guys.
And then you were hoping maybe Manning will be a bust, but last year he played great, but this year it is.
He's
eye of the tiger. I've never seen a guy play a better first four or five games of football.
And he's hilarious. How do you not like him? He's the funniest guy in the NFL, and he's on fire right now.
The desire is so there. You know, when he was at risk to never play again, you know, last year, no one thought he was going to be able to play the way he did.
Yeah, everyone's
and his criticism. Arm was weaker. His arm last year, he did not have zip on the ball. He has so vastly improved over the course of the last year from a physical perspective, just from nerves regenerating in his throwing arm.
Right.
So he saw the future of him not playing football, and he got a taste of what that could be like. So that just ignited the desire within him that was already more intense than anyone in NFL history.
Right.
The desire to win and prepare and
it's
make
funny.
Your team better around you.
We were at the Celebrity Beach Bowl that DirecTV does every year. Like they bring sand to the Super Bowl and celebrities play against pro athletes and stuff. And Peyton and Eli were at the game, and I didn't even know Peyton Manning knew I was alive, but I felt a tap on my shoulder and he said, "Artie, go deep down the side." And he had a ball, and he had a suit on, he had football, so I went, all right.
Yeah.
I ran down the sideline, he threw a perfectly leaded pass, I tried to catch up to it, and I fell on my face into the sand. I got up, and when I saw him, he went, that's on you, man.
I like he's still taking credit. But John, I think you're right, I think it was like a Christmas story where he saw the ghost of football future, and he's like, I got to win one more.
It's got to be ugly.
And they don't even have Von Miller back yet,
right?
Yeah. No, I mean, they're gonna be in
or Champ Bailey.
I think. They're gonna be. It's gonna be a matchup for the ages with him and Brady. I think some in the playoffs and some at some point.
Yeah.
And if they play it right, the NFL plays it right, they get them in the championship game.
They play each other in the regular season, I think, too. When is that, James? Broncos, Patriots. You know. Peyton Manning, just like you said, you didn't think he knew you were alive.
Right.
Yeah, we came out the same year in the draft. And, of course, I knew who he was because, at Tennessee, he was all world. But when we were at the rookie symposium, he came up to me and said, hey, John, how's it going? I was nobody, nobody at all. Peyton Manning. Knew who I was. This guy is such a fan of football that he knows who the fullback is from Stanford before he ever played a snap in the NFL.
You're going to be a starting fullback in the NFL.
It doesn't matter, man. The guy is—he cares so much about this game.
You're saying most quarterbacks would not have known who you were?
There's no way.
I think they would.
Percentage-wise of the NFL quarterbacks, are you saying is it less than 10% would have known who you were?
Probably. Yeah, man.
But I'm saying, like, that's how obsessed with football.
A different conference? Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you'll see on that movie that you're going to watch, he got tapes of his dad's games, audio tapes of his dad's games at Ole Miss when he was a little boy, and he would listen to them nonstop so that he knew every offensive linemen on his dad's Ole Miss team.
Yeah.
In their hometowns, where they were from. This guy is just obsessed.
That's a little weird.
About the game of football.
There's just a shed behind the Manning house, and it's like a beautiful mind. It's just a bunch of papers with red drawn on. He's like,
Daddy one time threw it to a guy named Roger Finney. He had 7 yards.
He'd be like, all right, just is this kid autistic? Yeah. I don't know what's going on.
And you see Eli just with his mouth open for walking around, and Cooper not paying attention to anything.
Cooper is playing Atari, and he should have gone out back.
Clearly the kid is. It's one of that's that thing with that book Outliers, where you got to love what you're great at to become a genius and do it for 10,000 hours.
You know what's a better?
That's what he is with football.
You know what's a better book than that? I'm reading it right now. It's called Talent Is Overrated, and he basically takes the Outliers thing and says that it's kind of true, but he does a thing called Applied Practice, and he uses Jerry Rice as the example, and he said Jerry Rice's training regimen in the offseason was specifically keyed to make him the greatest wide receiver of all time, because he had stamina, so he was fresher in the fourth quarter. Uh-huh. He had stronger. He'd do hand exercises, and people are like, "Why are you doing hand exercises?" So he could take the ball away from cornerbacks, and they had all these different exercises. And he said like this was his practice to make him Jerry Rice.
But isn't he also an example of a really talented guy too, though?
I mean,
he seems like a real talented guy too.
But how many talented wide receivers?
He was a 4'6" guy.
Yeah.
He was guy who physically, I got to play with Jerry, and it was one of the biggest thrills of my life. And he was a great, really cool dude. You know,
That's even better.
That's the thing. When he came into Oakland, I thought for sure, Tim Brown's a great guy.
Yeah,
very
it's unbelievable.
Religious man. And I always felt like, you know, I had to watch myself, watch what I say around Tim, because I didn't want to offend him. For some reason, I lumped Jerry in that same wheelhouse, kind of like, because he's an incredible future Hall of Fame receiver, he must be extremely disciplined and very, you know, pious. And
yeah,
it couldn't be farther from the truth. I mean, just the coolest guy
in
the world.
He's a real scumbag.
No, just a fun guy. I mean, just do what you're going to do. You know, he's going to do what he wants to do.
No morals.
Funny dude.
Yeah,
likes to have fun, but man. But the thing is,
What you're saying is...
There were so many people who were physically more skilled than Jerry Rice.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
And what you said, so he's not talented and
he was
don't
talented.
Turn your back on this
guy. He was talented.
You will kill someone.
But the work ethics, And Raymond Ferris was the guy who would train him in the offseason, and I went and tried to work out with him when I was getting ready for the combine, and it was nasty. I almost died.
Really?
Gotta take a break. Gotta take a break. We'll come back and we'll hear John bash Jerry Rice a little bit. Welcome back to the Artie Lang Show. Last few minutes of the first hour. Finishing up with Dan Soder. So what's coming up after Stress Factor, Bo? You got to use some more local stuff?
I'm gonna be at the Albany Comedy Works, and then I'll be in Seattle at the end of the month, Kirkland, Washington, at the Laughs stop. So that's... at Laughs, actually.
You fly into Seattle and go to Kirkland.
Yeah, drive to Kirkland, and I can't wear my Niner gear for
Be careful.
It's funny, because I had a layover in Seattle about 2 days ago, and I put my hat... I'm such just a
Do you travel with Niner gear? You're not big of a fan. You're hardcore.
Yeah, I'm a diehard Niner fan. I tend to always have something 49ers with me.
So going to Seattle, you're like, I got my hat.
But it's Seattle. It's not Oakland. It's not Detroit. It's not a place where it's like, they're going to be like, hey, I'm harshing your vibe. And you're like, all right, Seattle. Yeah. I'm not scared. You know what I mean?
I don't know. You never know. Maybe they could be, get a bad batch of the weed.
They're like, that tea, I didn't enjoy my tea this morning. Right. I'm going to slam this guy's head in.
Bad reaction from
Watch.
Their.
Because of this, I'm going to get into an altercation.
Well, I don't know. Yeah, you're right. I think you're kind of safe up there. But still, you never know with NFL fans, man. Like, out of nowhere, some town, you'll hear about, you know, guys just getting shot.
Well, it's like, it's especially crazy now that the NFL's gotten to the point where they have to put undercover police officers in opposing jerseys.
Yeah. That's up there with, the classic Philly at the vet when they put a judge in the basement of the vet in Philadelphia.
Oh, yeah, with the
Are
underground.
Are you too young to remember that?
No, I know the story.
Yeah. That's the best.
They have a courthouse in the current.
They do.
The Lincoln.
They still do, yeah. I mean, it's that bad. Those people are crazy.
Now, see, if I had a layover in Philly, and I was a Giants fan, I might be a little worried.
That's bad.
Seattle as a Niners fan, it's a good rivalry.
That's an intense – it's getting more and more intense because you got two head coaches who hated each other when they were college coaches.
Yeah.
And now you've got guys on the Seahawks who played for Harbaugh.
Yeah, Sherman
now
is,
seem to hate him.
Sherman is open about how much he hates Jim Harbaugh.
Yeah.
Right.
And I love it. And you know what I kind of like? You got to remember, when I was growing up, the Niners were like the lovable good guys. Yeah. They were the heroes. You had soft, white-haired Bill Walsh.
Turned a little more,
I like that we're kind of turning into the bad guys.
You're becoming like the 70s Raiders.
Oh, God, I hope. Because you want to be a fan of that team.
Oh, I love them. They were just scumbags on the best level.
Yeah.
Well, Dan Soda, thanks, buddy. Come back anytime. You got an open invite here. Stress Factory this weekend, and he's going to be in Albany. He'll be all over the place.
Yeah, well,
and
thanks for having me.
Were you at Dan Soder? What's the Twitter
thing? Twitter at Dan Soder.
At Dan Soder.
Yes,
but all right, Dan, great job, buddy.
Yeah, good seeing you guys.
We'll be back after these words.
The Artie Lang Show, weeknights on Audience, only on DirecTV.